It's indeed this afternoon a treat for us to have Senator Dole talk. We'd like to thank you on behalf of the organization for the time and the great chat that you did have with us. So I come from South Africa. It's a privilege to lead a great organization of 8,000 presidents globally and its owners. Yesterday we heard President Clinton talk, today we hear you talk. You're both so convincing. One key thought that I had as an outsider from miles and miles and miles away is the world is so dependent upon America. A strong America is a strong world. I have such a concern that starts with almost the anxiety and anguish that President Clinton had, and it stems from the media. The media are tending today to play more and more of a part, and it looks to me as though the next 10 months the media are also going to be playing a part, taking sides, health issues, pro-choice, not choice. There's a country to run. And I guess that the rest of the world is looking to somebody to take up the reins, to give a direction that the world can follow. I wish you good luck in your campaign. Thank you very much.
Republican pollsters looked us in the face and said, it is political suicide to say you're against the Clinton health care bill and to take it on head on. When Senator Dole and 21 other Republican senators signed on to a big government compromise that taxed your private health insurance benefits, that set up a national health board, that set up health care purchasing cooperatives, and that started a new health entitlement bigger than Medicaid, I stood up and said, the Clinton health care bill is going to pass over my cold, dead political body. I'm happy to say that my political body is alive and well, and here talking to one of the most dynamic groups of people in America, the Clinton health care bill is deader than Elvis. Elvis fans may be right, you may be not. But the Clinton health care bill will never be that. I want to cut government spending, not just to balance the budget, but I want to let working Americans keep more of what they earn. I want to let people invest more of their own money in their own children, in their own businesses, in their own futures. In 1950, the average family with two children sent one out of every $50 they earned in Washington, D.C. Today, that average family is sending one out of every $4 it earns to Washington, D.C. And in 20 years, if we don't start a single new program, if Congress didn't meet for 20 years, don't get your hopes. But if Congress did not meet for 20 years, didn't pass a single new law, but didn't repeal any old laws. In 20 years, that average family with two children, just to pay for the government we've already committed to today, is going to be sending one out of every $3 that family earns to Washington. Bill Clinton and the Democrats look at that trend and they say, great, let's accelerate. I look at it and say it has got to be stopped and it has got to be reversed. And I want to cut government spending and let families keep more of what they earn, and I want to do that this year. And Bill Clinton says, well, the debate is about how much money we want to spend on children, how much money we want to spend on housing, how much money we want to spend on nutrition. That's not what this debate is about. The debate is not about how much money we want to spend on children, housing, nutrition, all the things we agree money should be spent on. The debate is about who is going to do the spending. Bill Clinton and the Democrats want the federal government to do the spending. I want the family to do the spending. I know the government and I know the family and I know the difference. And if we're going to bet the future of America, and don't be confused about it, we are betting the future of America. If we're going to bet the future of America, I'm going to bet it on American families and not on the American government. I want to cut the capital gains tax rate. I want to cut marginal tax rates and move to a flat tax. Now, Bill Clinton would say, but if you cut tax rates, you're creating unfairness because rich people are going to mobilize their capital. They're going to invest it. They may create jobs, but if they are wise and successful in their investments, they're going to earn profits. Well, welcome to America. I am tired. Even Republicans apologizing for American free enterprise. I never apologize for it. What is fair about poverty? What is fair about economic stagnation? The idea the Democrats have about fairness is misery, where everybody's nose is rubbed into the misery. I want to eliminate the misery. Redistributing wealth has never reduced poverty, but creating wealth has always reduced it. I was thinking the other day, I've been blessed that I've had a lot of jobs in my life. As a child, I worked in a peanut processor, I worked in a cabinet shop, I worked in a boat factory, in addition to all the jobs we all did, working in the grocery store and throwing the newspaper. But as I was listening to Bill Clinton talk about tax cuts to the rich the other day, I started thinking, never in my life has a poor person hired me. Now, I don't think that experience is unique unto me. Every job I ever had in my life, I got because somebody beat me to the bottom rung of the economic ladder, climbed up before I did, saved their money, invested it wisely, created jobs, created opportunity that made it possible for someone like me to get my foot on the bottom rung of the economic ladder and start climbing up. The ultimate fairness in America is more opportunity, more investment, more jobs to let more millions of Americans do exactly what you have done. That's what I'm for. Finally, let me say, and throw it open for questions, we've got a lot of good people running for president. You had an opportunity to hear Bob Dole speak, I think to be interviewed by Ken, probably to answer your question. Bob Dole is a great and a good man and a dear friend of mine, and I would be very happy to have either one of my sons grow up to be like Bob Dole. But let me tell you why you ought to support me for president. You ought to support me for president because I am committed to fundamentally changing American government. We are not going to make America right again. We are not going to bring back the American dream by cutting deals in Washington, D.C. We're going to bring back the American dream and make America right again by standing up and fighting for the things we believe in. And I think you will find, when you get to know me better, the people that are for me and the people that are against me are for me and against me for exactly the same reason. They believe if I became president, it would make a big difference. If you want to change America, I'm your man. With that, let me stop, throw it open. I'd be very, very happy to try to answer any questions. Yes, ma'am. Lost the 1992 elections. because of the abortion issue. I personally don't believe it. I think that George Bush lost a lot of votes on the abortion issue. But I think it is very interesting that Ronald Reagan never lost a vote on the issue. And Ronald Reagan was hard for pro-life, which George Bush was not. The difference was that Ronald Reagan had a vision. And it was a vision that turned the Republican Party into a giant magnet. It was electrified by a vision of peace through strength and a vision of prosperity through limited government and free enterprise. And it was so appealing, so compelling, so unifying that it overrode the differences that we've had within the party. It united the Republican. It brought in independents, it brought in conservative Democrats, and it won the 80, the 84, and the 1988 election. There is no consensus on our part, in our party, or in the country, to overturn Roe versus Wade. We're going to have to build a party with a broad base. That does not mean we can't change the tax code and encourage marriage, for example. Why should two professionals who meet and fall in love have to pay $4,500 a year in a marriage penalty to be married? My wife's worth the $4,500. But many people who know me well question whether I am. And while there is no consensus on overturning Roe versus Wade, I do believe there is a consensus to change the adoption laws. I think there is a consensus to allow the states to have parental consent. I think there is a consensus to allow the states to ban late abortions when a child can die. I think those are areas where there can be a change. And obviously, in a free society, respecting each other's opinion, we have an opportunity to try to promote change in our society with welfare reform, where people come to respect themselves more and maybe respect their unborn children.
Eileen, go into the car and get that other battery for me, would you please? It's in the blue bag.
Speak on. This is one of the most beautiful pieces of beach